11 millimeter focal length. I think you could guess that, right?
I didn't even think of that.
Oh, Apollo 11. I feel like I should have known that. Yeah.
And
it's out there. 96% of the universe is still unexplored. A Schmidt-Cassegrain telescope, which is a very popular type of telescope. We've got more to learn. Tell us a little bit about it.
That's what I asked.
Well, yeah,
that would be real.
11 millimeter focal length. That's what I asked. I think you could guess that. Right?
I didn't even think of that.
Oh, Apollo 11. I feel like I should have known that. Yeah.
And 85 degrees of long eye relief and correction levels you've got to see to understand. This is about it.
19 millimeter eye.
And
almost 20.
Because 50 years ago,
with an 85 degree apparent field, that's really good.
And I worked on the simulator that trained the astronauts to land on the moon.
Now, am I remembering this correctly, that your particular aspect of the job was to look through, have the astronauts looking through a window, and that the field of view of that window was very wide field, and that's kind of the inspiration behind the Televue Eyepiece?
Wide field and short, and that's when I decided to make
So what you're saying is, let me understand this correctly. Are you saying that the actual windows on the lunar module were actually optical glass?
The windows on the module were optical glass, so they looked through optical glass. The windows were triangular. The circular field around the triangle was 110 degrees.
I like your cannon. That's a nice
camera. If you consider it an eyepiece. So what we designed was to present the astronauts the stars, a model. We didn't design that.
A buddy of mine just bought a Canon body. They make a 7D?
Model of the lunar landing site.
You remember Canon? They make a 7D?
And they had an optical probes moving over it. So in real time, they could simulate all of the motion. The optical probe was able to be a quarter of an inch above the model and still see everything in focus over 110 degrees.
So your inspiration for these is from your background with the Apollo program.
That's what started me on doing the Nagler eyepiece. But now that it's 50 years that we're celebrating, I said, what the heck? Let's push it one level further and celebrate it as a commemorative eyepiece, a limited edition. And this is the story. That's the simulator. So this is the optical design of the simulator. So that's a triangular lens that fit over the triangular window of the limb. You know how big that is. Okay?
Take care. Have a nice day.
So using mirrors and other lenses to feed this, we have a celestial sphere, a 3-foot diameter black globe with 1,000 embedded ball bearings for all the star images.
Oh my goodness.
Okay, and we had a TV with a spherical tube output so that when they look at the images from landing on the moon, it's projected on the TV. So everything is coordinated.
They feel like they're actually there, is what you're saying. So that this is one of the first flight simulators, am I correct in assuming that? Or at least one for the lunar missions?
I did the Gemini, and our company did the Mercury and Apollo as well. But I did the Gemini and the LEM. But this came from a book. Just read this one paragraph here. And at Stellafane 10 years ago, I met Alan Bean, fourth man to walk on the moon. And I handed him a little booklet I made with all these diagrams in it. And on the outside of the booklet, I wrote, "Dear Alan, glad it worked." But this tells that part of the story.
Since this is a quote that you felt was important, do you mind reading it for us?
Oh.
Would that be okay? No.
Apollo astronauts spent hundreds of hours training in these simulators in the months leading up to their missions. During each of the lunar missions, the astronauts inevitably compared the real experience of flying to the moon to the virtual experience that they encountered during training. The phrase, quote, "just like the simulator," can be found in the transcripts from every Apollo mission. quote from the book Apollo to the Moon, a history.
And you played a major role in this, and I really appreciate that you're out here today at the Black Forest Star Party to share this with us. I really appreciate your willingness to put together a commemorative eyepiece for this amazing historic event.
Well, you know, my talks are titled, I Thank My Lucky Stars. I just happen to be in the right place at the right time.
I actually plan on being at NEAF this year. Okay. Hopefully we're able to make
That's
it.
That's me in high school.
That's with you in high school?
Oh, wow. Telescope.
Wow, that is awesome, Al.
You gotta get a picture of that.
Now, Al, is this a telescope that was
I built.
You made? I thought so.
The whole thing.
Wow, that's amazing.
So you built this while you were in high school? How old were you?
About 15.
15 years
16.
Old.
So. And that got me the Shop Award, and that enabled me to write an article on how I built it for Mechanics Illustrated magazine.
Did that help you in your leading up to the eventual goal?
Yeah, it got me the job in the optical company when I showed them the article I built on building the telescope.
So I'm actually a high school teacher during the daytime, so can I just ask you to kind of tell high school students, like, what did this mean to you at the time? Like, why did you, what made you feel like this is something you wanted to do?
I was a poor kid from the Bronx. I had a couple of a small telescope. I loved astronomy when I went to the planet. My father took me to the planetarium. So I said, how can I have a big telescope? And the only way is possible is really to make one.
To make one.
How could I make one? Well, I knew that the Bronx High School of Science had a class called Scientific Techniques Laboratories, which allowed students to do anything they wanted. So, and they had a great shop.
We'd call that a maker space in today's speak.
Okay. Well, my speak, boy, it was an opportunity.
Awesome.
So I got into Bronx Science. I spent a year working on the project, working with my shop teacher, who many years later I gave him one of my telescopes.
Oh, that's awesome,
and,
Al.
And that's also in my talk. But anyway, so
we'll link getting, to the talk getting, that Al has.
Getting the shop award enabled me to write an article for Mechanics Illustrated magazine on how I built it. And coincidentally, one of the directors of Ferrand Optical Company, a research firm in the Bronx, he wrote articles for Sky and Telescope on building telescopes as a hobby. Talk about putting everything together.
Yep.
So I walked into his office, showed him the article Mechanics Illustrated, said, any possibility of a job? I was at that point a draftsman a couple of years out of high school. I said, you become a draftsman. A year later, says, how would you like to join the optical design department? So I worked on all kinds of projects, and you saw the night vision project?
Yep.
In 1971, I designed the eyepiece for that for AT&T goggles.
Talk about a long time coming, right?
Talk about, you never know. You never know how
and
to
And keep track of what work
circles.
You've done, right?
Right.
Don't lose the work you've already done. Keep track of, write notes down. Take notes.
So anyway, so I have a strong philosophy about what amateur astronomers can do, especially now in our critical time of climate change when we have to save the planet. And I feel that amateur astronomers, because of their connection to the universe, because of knowing the beauty of the universe, have perhaps a duty, if not just a wish, to work on anything that will help save the planet.
I have an important question, and I think everybody needs to understand. Al, everybody, I think, in this community can agree that you're one of the most inspiring and successful people. You have the best optics for eyepieces out there. But can you share with us what your biggest personal challenge or experience has been, where you feel like you're still trying to learn? What's something that you're personally still learning?
Well, I'm learning more about the electronic end of it. And I'm learning that if something can make a difference, if you can make a product better, more useful to a lot of people, and that's why I got into the night vision, because I realized that that's an area where you could look through a 30-inch telescope and make it look like a 90-inch telescope.
Right.
Okay? And anything that expands the interest and the field of amateur astronomy. I feel whether it's of any financial value to me, it's minimal. It's something, it's just a passion that I like to connect, and I love working with kids.
Me too. Thank you again. I appreciate it.